Welcome, Bubba. I'm Venarti Scribe, author, businesswoman, and your host for the next hour. This live stream is dedicated to love, sex, acceptance, and understanding the lifestyle and ultimate sensuality. Trust me, lover, the knowledge I drop will be straight, no chaser. So sit back and prepare yourself. It's about to get naughty.
Welcome, lovers. I'm the Naughty Scribe, and once again, you have tuned in to the Nice and Naughty Hour. Well, we've had a lot of fun, and of course, I hope everyone had a safe, joyous, feastful, and blessed Thanksgiving. But now it's time to get back into the naughtiness of life, and we're going to start off with our, of course, what the fuck moment. I told you it was going to be a what the fuck moment. That's going to be set clip one.
What the fuck?
There we go. See, we're still having a little bit of turkey trauma right now. Okay. All right. Now, this video has been viral on YouTube, on the news, on Facebook, and all over the place. Lovers, you know, I do not hate on my professionals, prostitutes, okay? I don't hate on these females at all. To me, they're providing a service that's in demand, and I do believe that Nevada got it right. Don't hate it, regulate it, okay? Get your taxes on it, because, hey, it's a lot of hoes paying for roads, schools, and police services. Speaking of police services, you're going to have to see this video, and we'll talk about it later. So, lover, can I get that video, please?
Yeah. You must be suspended from school. Ow. What's your number? Man, I ain't scared to fuck with nobody. What you talking about?
Okay, well, why you act like you can't go to a room? Fuck, shit, ain't nobody gonna know what we do in a room.
I'm
gonna take care of you, so.
You can take care of me, but I don't go to room.
Okay, well, what the hell you go? How you do grown folk shit then? What are you talking about you gonna go for?
Okay, you make like, I can't stand here and talk to you.
Oh, boy, I mean, I ain't coming to talk and shit. I wanna do more than talk.
I don't know what you mean.
She's smart because.
Oh, so you the same here in front.
I don't fuck. I'm dead serious, I don't fuck. But I'm gonna call you, okay? I ain't sure wait.
Okay, lovers, so there's a couple of what the fucks in that video. First of all, the big glaring one. Yes, lovers, that was a cop on duty in Mississippi in his cop car. And yes, lovers, he was soliciting, you guessed it, a prostitute. And not only was he soliciting a prostitute while on duty, in uniform, in his car, he was soliciting a minor. Yes, lovers, the young lady in question, which is why we can't throw no names out there, was a minor. She was a minor and a known prostitute. So when Officer Friendly, whose name, because stuff ain't been finalized, so we can't be putting people out there like that. I try to be fair, but damn, dude, you on video, okay? And you on YouTube. So I'm thinking this is some fucked up shit. Now, for me, it's even more fucked up because it was a brother who should have known better, okay? Who should have known better, okay? So this is, you know me, lovers, I love a sexual scandal that involves a little bit of crime. But damn, I'm sorry, we're gonna have to do this one for the team. With all the cops that are shooting black people and brown people out there, yes, I'm sorry, because I got cops in my family. I used to work for law enforcement, so forgive me. But I'm laughing my ass off at this one because it's stupid on so many levels. One, Motherfucker, you on duty. You are in a cop car, in uniform, on duty, trying to get some pussy. And not even trying to get legal pussy. You're trying to get a minor's ass. Okay, do you know how all kinds of fucked up that is? You're supposed to be to serve and protect, and your ass is trying to get it with a minor. And she's a pro. So not only are you trying to get it with someone legally because of her age, you ain't got no fucking business messing with, you're trying to get a prostitute, which is also illegal in Mississippi, while you're on duty, in uniform, in your car. Okay. And here's the delicious part. I was just messing with Wiley, my engineer, about this. He's like, he couldn't tell that she was filming him? No, because this is a pro on so many levels. Because this young lady, when, if you notice at the beginning of the video, she was already talking to a potential customer when the cop pulled up. So, like most black people have to do now, first thing you do when Popo pull up on you, you hit record on your phone. And this heifer was so slick that she held the phone in such a way that she could get him. That's why you saw the movement. She didn't pretend she didn't have her phone on him. She just didn't let him know she was filming his ass, okay? So here we go. This cop gets fired, needless to say. Now, here I am playing devil's advocate. Would it have been entrapment if it was a white cop? Would we be trying to understand and say the cop was, you know, in fear of lack of pussy, which is, you know, because they seem to be scared of every damn thing else and get away with it. So maybe, you know, he was in fear of not busting a nut and therefore, you know, the jury's going to let him off for being a good cop. Okay, don't know. But I do know that this black cop got terminated quick, fast, in a hurry. And the police chief made it a point, someone else was black, made it a point of saying that this does not represent his people. Now, I'm going to get in trouble because, yes, again, I used to work with law enforcement. I have law enforcement and military in my family. So you know I love my boys in blue. But I love my boys in blue like you love a husband, not like you love your mother. And what I mean by that is, people tend to idolize their mother and never want to believe that she fucks, never want to believe that she curses, never want to believe that she does anything wrong. My children are a little more realistic because I'm honest with them. But people have a tendency to treat their mothers like they're saints. And we do the same thing with police officers. We tend to forget that police officers are human beings. They were not drafted to be police officers. They volunteered. This is something they wanted to do because, genuinely, I do believe every police officer who takes the off initially, they really do want to protect and serve. I will give them that benefit of the doubt. But something happens once they get the uniform on. Something happens when they go into certain neighborhoods. And what I'm sick and tired of, yes, I'm going to say it as somebody with a permanent tan, is my skin color does not define who I am, does not define what I'm going to be, what I'm capable of. My heart, my mind, my spirit, and my determination do that for me. My skin color is indication of the tribe I was born into. And my tribe just happens to be of African descent, which I am very proud of. But that being said, because I have a permanent tan, does not give you the right to be so fearful of me that it's an automatic death sentence. Because let's face it, lovers, if the roles were reversed and black people started saying, brown people started saying, hey, wait a minute, 9 times out of 10, when I see a cop and they shoot someone black, they get off on it. I'm black. I have a right to be fearful of someone in a blue uniform. Therefore, I should take preemptive measures, which is what the cops do. I feared for my safety, and the data backs it up because there's a hell of a lot of black and brown people being fatally shot by police. We have 2 cases going on now. One, as I came in tonight, the white police officer will not be facing any charges. This is the gentleman who shot the black man who had a gun, yes, in an open carry state, who was told by the police to drop it. There ensued an argument. He did not drop the gun. The gun was pointed at the ground. The gun was by his at his side. He did, his arm was at his side. He did not drop it. The police officer feared that any moment he could pull the gun up, raise the gun up, and shoot him, so he shot him to death. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. In this particular case, I'm going to get in trouble for it. I see the cop's point. You have a gun in your hand. Yes, it's an open carry state, but once a cop walks up on you and tells you to drop your weapon, you fucking drop your weapon. Let it go. Worry about your civil rights afterwards. If you didn't do anything wrong and he pulled you up, you get Johnny Cochran's team together, you get Al Sharpton, you get Jesse Jackson, you pull all these motherfuckers out here looking for a camera and a cause, and you picket the hell out of police, and you let them know that you're not asking to be treated like a U.S. citizen. You are a U.S. citizen with all the protections of the Constitution, and you demand your rights. It's not optional for a police officer to decide whether or not he's going to obey the Constitution when it comes to your skin color, okay? That's not an option. That being said, I do believe that some of these tragic shootings are because black people keep forgetting. The Constitution doesn't fully apply to us as it does everybody else. We have to bring it to the attention that it did not apply to us and make it an issue before it's retroactively applied to us. And what I mean by that is you do have the right to tell a police officer he cannot search your vehicle, he cannot enter your home, he cannot check your persons without a warrant. The second that you do invoke your constitutional right against unreasonable search and seizure, suddenly you're a threat and you get shot. Now, no one wants to talk about whether the cop was right in his assessment of you being a threat initially, or did he even have correct cause, proper cause to stop you to begin with. The second case we talked about, again, is the shooting where the cop said that the black man, again, took his taser and aimed it at him. This is before he realized that a bystander was shooting the whole thing, and what actually happened was the gentleman was running away from the police officer, was over 18 feet away, well past any margin where he could have effectively used the taser, and was shot several times in the back. While the man is on the ground dying, you do see on the video, again, caught by a bystander, same bystander, that the police officer drops something by the person who is on the ground, face down, bleeding to death, literally, and saying, let go of my gun, let go of my taser, while the man is laying there on the ground. He is literally, because I've been watching this in court, saying he feared for his life. I don't know how you could have feared from an unarmed black man running away from you who's already 18 feet away from you when you start shooting. But again, dark skin, the worst your sin. So when I see the tables reversed, as unfair to some of my men in blue as it may be, and it is, and I'm admitting to that, I cannot help but feel like there's a little bit of karmic justice coming into play, because this shows not only was this cop flawed, he was, not only was this cop willing to do something that he knew was illegal, he was, but it shows the humanity. Because if you have, I'm sure this police officer had, outside of this incident, I'm sure he did an exemplary job protecting and serving his community. And the fact that he was a black cop meant that he was trying to be part of the solution, not part of the problem, because more of us need to be included in the police force so that other officers understand that we're here, that we're human beings too, and we have the same ambitions and dreams and desires for a safe community as you do. That being said, if people stop seeing cops as demigods and superheroes and start, in my honest opinion, seeing them like they see their neighbors as a human being who can lie as well as be honorable, who can fuck up as well as overcome any obstacle, who can be dirty as hell as well as honorable as hell, maybe then we'll start understanding that everybody they shoot was not justified just because they were black or came from a lower social economic system, okay? So yes, when I see videos like this, I think it just proves our point that cops are not pure as Caesar's wife. They're human and flawed like everybody else. They're capable of greatness And they're also capable of fucking up royally. And that's our what the fuck moment. We're going to jump into a quick break and I'll see you in one. Thank you. Welcome back, lovers. This is the Naughty Scribe, and once again, you're on the Nice and Naughty Hour. So now that we got our what the fuck moment out the way, we're going to have a little bit of fun, a little bit more naughty fun. Now, tonight's topic is going to be flirting via social media. Necessary tool or troller's paradise. Now, before we get into it, what do we mean by social media flirting? Okay, it's basically what you do on the street when you see a fine brother or an exceptionally voluptuous sister and you want to talk with them. Okay, it's that little tease that you give them to let them know that you find them attractive, desirable, and more importantly, pursuable. Okay, so that's what we mean by flirting. Now, social media is exactly what it sounds like. You're doing the same thing, only you're doing it by Facebook, you're doing it by tweet, you're doing it by, well, sometimes you can do it by Tumblr, but not that often. You're doing it, I've seen it done on Instagram. So you're basically using the social networking devices and apps and platforms in order to pursue someone of interest. Now, there are some common terms. Because if you're going to get engaged in it, one thing you need to know, and I ain't talking about our youngins, I'm talking about us grown-ass motherfuckers, okay? There's certain common terms you need to be aware of, because a couple of weeks ago, we did a show on sexting, which is texting sexually explicit or suggestive messages or pics to a potential partner or lover, okay? Hence the term sexting. And we did have to talk a little bit about etiquette in the digital world or cyber world. And what was so funny was when I sat down and talked with my little crew, yes, this of mixed ages, when I sat down and talked to my little crew about it, certain terms were thrown out. And it was funny as hell that some people thought they meant one thing and others thought they meant another. So some of the terms we're going to talk about, if I can get that 2A up. Darling? Pick 2A. Okay, so there we go. So some of the terms that came up were bae, thought, ghost, fading, back burner or benching, depending on your nationality, because, you know, some of my sisters and brothers call it back burner, others called it benching, okay, but I knew what they meant. Jelly, which is kind of silly, but I knew what that one was, but it was funny. It was funny. And 143. Okay. Now, I'll be honest with you. 143, that's the new one on me. That's the one I did not know, and I got an education. So I want to thank my little crew for throwing out terms out there. So we're going to get into what those are, but not the second. You're going to have to wait on that one. Okay. All right. So let's talk about some pros and cons of flirting on social media. One of the pros is it's fast. Okay. One of the cons is it's fast. Okay. And what I mean by that is the second you hit send, that bitch is gone. So Also, if you said something that maybe you want to think about 2 seconds after you hit send, it ain't happening. Recall is a lot slower than getting that instant message out there, okay? So if you're instant messaging, direct messaging, Snapchatting, messaging on Facebook, or doing Google Hangout, even if you're video chatting, if you're doing Skype, be cognizant of the fact that once you hit enter or send, that shit's out there now. Okay, and you can't always pull that back before the person that you sent it to gets it. Now, why is that a pro and a con? Pro, if I want to tell you, hey, what I saw last night really did interest me. Let's talk some more. And you got it? Good. If I said to you, hey, I couldn't get to sleep last night, you know what I mean? Maybe you should think about coming over. And I hit send, then I think, wait a minute, my man's gonna be home tonight. Maybe I shouldn't have invited you. Let me get this back. Heifer, you done sent a message out. Now you got another brother coming over while your main man is in the shower thinking he's gonna get lucky tonight because he done took care of some stuff, like some bills, your car, took the trash out, would have been told about it. So he done did his good boy job. He's expecting to get his grown man reward. You just fucked up because now you just sent a message. That's how fast can get you in trouble. You just sent a message to another brother whose dick is hard and he's been waiting on that cue for you to head over. And here's another thing. When you hit send, sometimes we read those messages and depending on what you send out, we don't feel it necessary to hit you back and say, we got it. We just show up. Okay, because let's be honest. If you tell me, you need to come hit this tonight, be here in 30 minutes, what the fuck do I need to call you for? I'm going to be there in 29.5 minutes. I'll see you when I get there. So, yeah, you take a risk with using social media. There's pros and there's cons, but again, it's fast. And in conjunction with being fast, it's also too easy and too convenient. That's a pro and a con. And what do I mean by too easy and too convenient being a pro and a con? I can send Wally a nice little message right here off my tablet. Yeah, Wally, I'm just messing with you. He's happily married. Don't worry about it, ladies. But he is cute, I will tell you. But anyway, hey, nothing wrong with a little eye candy during breaks. But that being said, don't worry, Mrs. Wiley. It's all professional. He knows I just be fucking with him. But anyway, hey, I ain't trying to get my ass beat on TV, okay? But anyway, I can send Wiley a message. It's just easy and convenient. Everyone has their tablets with them. Everyone has a phone with them. Everyone is on their computer. As we speak, almost every last one of you who is watching this live stream is doing it from a mobile device. Okay, whether it's your laptop or hell, it might be your Google Watch for all I know, okay? Because some of them are like that, okay? But the point is, that same device that you're watching this show on, you might be sitting in the bathroom, you might be sitting in your car, you might be like me, reading while you're doing laundry, okay? Or watching it in the bathtub, getting your little naughty soap on, because I know a few of you do it. Okay, just to say, 50 fluffy and fine works for some of you, and I'm very appreciative that it does. But that being said, okay, some of you can send little things out there, and then once they're gone, you're like, maybe I shouldn't have shown her that. Maybe I shouldn't have sent her that. That's what I mean by too quick and easy. Things that are too quick, too easy, too convenient, we don't think twice before we send shit out. And that's the problem. When it takes a minute, and yes, I'm getting ready to go old school on you, when we had to do this thing called writing, which was using pen and paper, we actually had to think about what it was we wanted to communicate. Because we, one, wanted to look neat, so we didn't want to do a lot of erasing and scratching and all this other bullshit. And also, we wanted to convey clearly what we meant. So, yes, we did take our time when we had to write it in pen and paper. We take a little more time with emails. Not a whole hell of a lot. But we do seem to sit down and take our time when we're doing emails because of the same principle, that we want to get out exactly what we're trying to say. We don't want there to be any misunderstanding. And like writing with pen and paper, with email, I have a chance to go back and review what I've written, make some changes, tone it down, pump it up, make it a little friendlier, make it a little more neutral. I have opportunity to go back and edit myself. When you're texting, when you're sending instant messages, when you're sending direct messages, when you're doing Google Hangout, Snapchatting, whatever, it is instant, okay? And when it's instant, the self-editing has a tendency to happen after you've sent the damn message. So if you didn't really mean to tell me that my boobs were bodacious and you would like some time between the both, and I've only met you like 2 seconds ago, you told me really what you were thinking. And trust me, under the right circumstances, that's a go. But not 2 seconds after I've met you. You have to get to know all of me before you get to know the hoe, okay? Sorry, lady first, hoe second. That's the order of things, okay? And I'm an ethical hoe, so I'm putting it out there. I'm telling you now, you gotta spend some time. And just finish telling somebody else. Just because I'm an open and out there lifestyler, swinger, does not mean I'm public property. You do still have to earn some shit. Being a lifestyler means I'm just open to expressing my sexuality in ways that maybe some people aren't, okay? And I don't apologize for that, because unless you can walk across water, boo-boo, I haven't met anybody yet who has the authority to judge me, okay? That being said, again, when you want to chat with me or anybody else that you find desirable, be very careful when you're using social media. Because, again, we have a tendency to be very impulsive when we're using social media. And that's just a nice way of saying we jump before we think, okay? So if you see something that you think, damn, that bitch got a fat ass, and you text that shit to her, maybe it's not the fat ass part she got offended by. Maybe it's that bitch line that she got pissed off about. But because you jumped the gun, and you thought about, maybe I shouldn't have called her a bitch just yet, but you already hit send, it's a little late. And that's what I mean by being impulsive and by social media being too fast, too convenient, and just too easy to use, because it doesn't always lend itself to us filtering ourselves or editing ourselves before we make an ass out of ourselves, okay? Just keeping it real. Okay, also too, there is a good and a bad, but I'm gonna be honest with you, mostly I have found it to be a negative, not mostly a positive, and that's the sense of anonymity. When you meet someone and or you see someone's picture, because it happens to me quite often, you see someone's picture on Facebook or Google or whatever, and you find them attractive, and you want to approach them. So you send them a message that you think is cute and sexy, but you say shit that you would never say to my face. And this is something, lovers, I have never understood. Why do you think that you can just come out and say any damn thing you want to me, or to anyone for that matter, that you are attracted to, or maybe not even attracted to? Some of you think I'm too fucking fluffy, okay? And my, you know, response to you is, fuck you, I'm not for you. Okay, it's just that simple. This ain't for everybody, okay? I don't waste my time on those of you who don't roll with that. It's a waste. I concentrate on those who think I'm a goddess, as I am, and hey, we can work with that, okay? But that being said, some of you feel that you can just come out of your mouth and say whatever the fuck you want to, and that's your right of free speech. But you seem to be real thin-skinned when you put on blast, as if your right to free speech somehow means I lose mine. No, boo-boo, I don't. And neither do those who support me, who then troll your ass behind that shit. And I'm saying that for a reason. Because if you rule of thumb with social etiquette, and I'm talking about social media etiquette, is if you can't say it to someone's face, you shouldn't say it at all. And that's a good policy to have regardless of whether it's on social media, whether it's on the phone, whether you're chatting with your boys or your girls about someone in particular. If you would not say that particular thing to their face, you shouldn't be saying it, because eventually it does have a tendency to get back to that person. And maybe you said something on an off moment that you really didn't mean to get out there. Once it's out there, you don't have any control of how I perceive it. Maybe you meant it as a compliment, you know, too fat, black, and nappy. Or maybe you didn't, and I took it as a negative, even when you meant it as a positive. Again, if you can't say it to someone's face, if you would be mortified if it was repeated that you said this about someone, you shouldn't be texting it, you shouldn't be instant messaging it, you shouldn't be relaying it in any way, shape, or form, okay? So that said, we're going to go into our next break and we'll be back in one. Lovers, I'm the Naughty Scribe, and once again, you're on the Nice and Naughty Hour. So in our previous segment, we kind of talked a little bit about flirting via social media and some of the etiquette that goes with it. Now, remember that because some of the pros and cons are that it's are the same, that they're too fast, too easy, and too convenient to use, that we don't always filter ourselves. So you do want to kind of keep that in mind before you send anything out there into the Ethernet. Also, that sense of anonymity. We have a tendency to somehow believe that what we text or what we put on Facebook, no one's ever going to know about it, or because they don't see us actually do it, even though they're reading it on your page, that it gives empowers us to say things or do things that we just would not do or say in person. And that sense of anonymity can be a positive, but more often than not, it's a negative. Now, I talked about where it's a negative, but here's where it can be a positive. It's like someone getting a boost of confidence. Maybe there is someone that you're attracted to, and you've never had the courage to tell them to their face. You become buddies with them on Facebook, or on you put them in your circle on Google Plus, or you add them as a friend on your Instagram. Now, because there is that digital shield between the two of you, you might say, hey, I really like that picture I saw of you at Starbucks. You look kind of cute in your uniform. How about I come over one day and we have a share a latte and talk about our interests? I mean, that can embolden someone who is shy by nature, who probably would not walk up to this person at Starbucks and say, hey, you're kind of cute. You know, you're interested in having a conversation or something. So that's where it can be a positive. It's all like anything else in how you use it or abuse it, okay? One last thing on that segment I want to wrap up. Clearly, we have new lingo that comes into play, but sometimes things get lost in translation. And I'm going to go over a little something that happened not too long ago. Met this fine, and I ain't gonna lie, fine piece of eye candy, okay? Everything going for him from the head to the toe, okay? And yes, me like I'm tall. I'm 5'1", so it ain't hard to be taller than me, okay? Little conversation got going, okay? There was a misunderstanding between us, again, by texting, okay? One of the problems with texting in particular is that your words can be taken literally, and we're going to get more into that in this segment. So can I get that flag on the play, baby? Okay, so as I was just mentioning, sometimes things are not perceived the way you meant them to be. Because remember, when you're texting, especially when you're texting, if you're sending out words to me, I have not spoken to you on the phone. Because let's face it, a lot of initial interaction when you're flirting with someone is not face to face. Your first meeting might not have ever happened face to face. It may literally be on social media. It might have been in a Google Hangout. It might have been in a group chat on Facebook. It might have been I was looking for a particular hashtag, researching a particular hashtag on Twitter, and you came up, and I thought, hey, kind of nice. Look at your profile. Saw that you were available and approached you. So literally, that first interaction does not always have to be in person, and a lot of times it really isn't. In person, face-to-face comes much later, which means that your interactions by social media, by Facebook, especially by texting, because we do that a hell of a lot, the words you use are even more important, because I don't know the sense of you as a person. I don't know your idiosyncrasies. I don't know when you're joking or when you're serious. I don't know what ticks you off and what you just blow off. I don't know any of those things about you. Only thing I know is that you found me attractive and you approached me, okay? So sometimes what you type then, what you text, is taken literally because I have no other sense of you. The only thing I can do is read what you've sent to me and look at it and say, okay, well, that's what you meant. So let's use this scenario, for instance. I meet an attractive young lady, okay? She's feeling me, I'm feeling her. Okay, we exchange phone numbers. Okay, we're not talking to each other because for whatever reason we just text each other. Okay, but we text each other quite a bit over the first couple of weeks. Okay, well, if the first text I send you is how you really blew me away physically, how I really appreciate what I saw, and then the next text is, when can I get some alone time with you so that I can get to know you better? Okay, I might take you at face value. But then if the next one after that is, I can't wait to lick your bald head. And yes, I actually do have a picture of a woman licking my bald head. I will bring it to you next week. But, and some of you have already seen it because it's on my Facebook page. But if the next thing out of your mouth or out of your fingers is, I can't wait to lick that bald head of yours. And then you follow that with, hey, I get off work. I don't live too far from where we met. Why don't you come over and we can share a bottle of wine and seriously get to know each other. If there is a pattern of you expressing wanting to be alone with me, along with physical desire for me, have a right to then think, okay, wait a minute, you're moving a little fast, honey. You're now inviting me to your place after you just told me you found my booty bodacious, you can't wait to lick my head, and you keep asking to be alone with me. Now I tell you, hey, pump your brake a little bit. Yes, you know, I'm open to a lot of things and I'm not ashamed of that, but you still got to earn this. You got to work your way to this. This is not, you know, this is not bargain basement booty. Everybody doesn't get a try at this, okay? And then you get mad at me. You get so mad at me that now you're confrontational and you're angry with me because I perceived what you said to me through text. Because remember, we haven't talked on the phone. We don't have a sense of each other. All I know is the pattern of messages you've been sending me. So where you thought you were being flirty, I thought you were being basically a little fast, that you were being a little suggestive. Because none of your texts ask me about the show. None of your texts ask me about my work. None of your texts ask me about my writing. None of your texts ask me anything about me as a person. Everything was leading toward a sensual, if not sexual, interest in me. So maybe you did mean that you wanted me to come up to your place and share a bottle of Zen and just sit down and really get a chance to talk to each other in a comfortable environment, albeit you got the advantage because it's your place. But maybe that is what you meant. That's not necessarily what was perceived. The follow-up to that, though, is you got confrontational when I basically told you to pump the brake. This is where you really show me who you are. Because if your go-to response at being misunderstood is to then become hostile, to become defensive, and in some case, becoming very rude in your language, now I have a totally negative opinion about you. Where first I looked at you and thought, you know, I could see this, me and this sister having a little fun. Now it's gone to, okay, wait a minute. She's got anger management issues, okay? She's quick to prejudge the very thing she told me she didn't want me to do. She clearly doesn't have a problem doing it herself, so that also makes her a hypocrite. And then, because of the way you approached me, because of the way something didn't go your way, so the first thing you do is become angry or hostile about it, that tells me that you're too quick-tempered and you're too easy to find offense where there is none. If you are offended by a simple text with someone you don't have a connection or a commitment with, what would it be like if you and I were actually to become involved, where we did share our bodies, our emotions, and maybe parts of our lives with one another, depending on how it went and something didn't go your way? So you let me know a lot more about you simply by the way you reacted to what could have very well been a misunderstanding on my part. But again, one of the things I tell you, lovers, is check yourself before you check someone else. If anybody else could have looked at those text messages that you were sending, those instant messages that you were sending, those direct messages you were sending, who doesn't know you, and said, yeah, that's moving a little fast, don't you think? Or how come she doesn't ask you anything other than sensual stuff? Maybe it was you, boo-boo. Maybe you didn't mean it that way, but maybe you put it in such a pattern or started such a pattern going that was the obvious conclusion. So check yourself first before you check someone else. Make sure that you are in the right, because the last thing you want to do with someone that you are potentially interested in is to put them on the defensive, because once you put someone on the defensive, they're going to become Johnny Cochran and they're going to go through every text and every message that you sent them to prove to you that they weren't out of line by what they felt and said, that it was reasonable. Okay, and I'll be honest with you, the sex appeal after that goes down to nil for some. Now, ladies, I'm going to jump on your ass for a hot second here with that one, because this incident did happen with someone close to me. If someone shows you the very worst of them off the break, I mean literally shows you the worst of them, please believe it. It is not a one-off. It is not a bad day. It is not, oops, my bad, that's normally not who I am. Yes, it is. When people are angry, it is just like when they are drunk. You get a peek into who they are. Now, is this who they are 24/7? No, not necessarily, but it is a part of who they are, a big part, because when we are vulnerable, when we feel self-righteous or an injustice has been done to us, we tend to go into battle mode, and battle mode is us amped up, okay? So if someone already shows you that they have a quick temper, if someone already shows you that they're real quick to be very rude and nasty or hostile, if someone shows you that they're hypocritical because they're willing to do to you what they claim they didn't want you to do to them, you need to take a good look at that and ask yourself, is this something you want to deal with? Is this something you want to pursue? Now, I'll be honest with you. Sometimes it's like, that's not necessarily a deal breaker, but it should damn well be a reason to pump them brakes and pump them hard, okay? Like damn near full stop, okay? Let's see if this shit happens again. For some of us, it's a no-go, because to be honest with you, I ain't got patience for that bullshit. I just don't, okay? Been there, done that. And when somebody shows you that part of their character, it really is part of their character. And not everybody has the temperament or the patience to put up with it. They just don't. If someone doesn't have control of themselves, they don't have control of themselves. And they need to work on that before they can work on anybody else. Now, that being said, there are a couple of other do's and don'ts that I want to get into. And we're going to do that real quick after this next break. back, lovers. I'm the Naughty Scribe, and once again, you're on a nice and naughty hour. Now, in an earlier segment, we talked about terms that you should know and get familiar with, and let me tell you, lovers, I learned a couple new ones, especially that 143, which I had no idea about, so it was kind of fun. So, yes, crew, I'm giving you a shout-out. Yay! But I want to bring up the answer. So let's see how well you really did. So can I get that 2B? Okay. Bae is just a short version of saying babe. Okay? So bae is not short for Beyonce or Lady Bae. It is babe. Okay? Thought all of us around a certain neighborhood know what the fuck it is. And that means that hoe over there. Now, thought is just, to be honest with you, another way of saying bitch, okay? We're going to be straight up with that one. But it doesn't have to be a particular female. It doesn't have to be a particular location, meaning over there where Wiley is standing, or over here where I am, or over there by the 7-Eleven. It just means that hoe over there is another way of saying that bitch, okay? Ghost is sudden cutoff. That's when you're having conversation with someone by social media. In particular, whether you're texting on a regular basis or you're instant messaging or even having a phone call, you know, the occasional phone call, because yes, we do actually use our phones to talk to people. But ghost is when someone just totally drops the conversation or relationship altogether. They don't return your calls. They don't return your messages. No nothing, as the term goes. They just ghost. Now, that's a cowardly way to break up with someone. That's a cowardly way of telling someone I'm not interested. But the idea is that if you don't return their messages to you, after a while they'll get the message and just stop fucking trying to talk to you. Fading or slow fade is the same thing. It's a gradual cutting off. So maybe you don't, Wiley doesn't stop talking to me tonight. He may take a couple of days to stop talking to me. Maybe where Wiley and I are texting each other 3 times a day, he'll only text me twice. Then the next day, he'll only text me once. Then he'll only text me once a week. Then he'll only text me once every 2 weeks. Then he'll stop texting me altogether. That's a slow fade, where you gradually wean someone off, or you wean off of communicating with them or having a relationship with them. Again, it's a cowardly way of doing it, but it's a little nicer than ghosting. Benching or back burner. Now, most of my set know it as back burner, but some of the younger crew call it benching because they're sports fans. But basically, that's keeping a secondary relationship. In other words, somebody doesn't go out with you, but they always want to make plans to go out. Somebody is always hitting you up to ask how your day is, but or want to chat with you, but they really don't seem to have anything to talk about. They just seem to want to constantly keep you in the loop, keep you, you know, hanging in there, because they're making just enough contact with you so that you don't take them off as a Facebook buddy or block them from instant messaging you or whatever. They're hitting you up on a semi-regular basis. The reason that they're doing that is because they have a fear of being alone. This is a person who most likely has a main relationship that they're not 100% happy in. And what they want to do is keep their options open. They don't want to go through a period of being alone and starting over again. So they keep, yes, you guessed it, somebody on the back burner or on the bench. Just like a football game or a baseball game, you don't put all your players on the field. You put your main ones on the field, you keep your backup on the bench. In case something happens to that star pitcher, you got someone you can roll with and not have to stop the game, postpone, or whatever. Same thing with backbenching or back burner. It's basically a backup person that you have a secondary relationship with, and very secondary relationship with, but you keep them on the hook. In case things with your main relationship doesn't work out, you can slide right into that one and amp it up and make that one your front burner relationship. It's also, in my view, a punk-ass move, but it's done a lot. The next one, Wiley got it absolutely right. He just wasn't supposed to tell you. Jelly is a silly way of saying jealous. Now, jelly, however, I found out the hard way, in a funny way, actually can set off somebody like you would never believe. You don't have to call them jelly. You can literally just send them a meme of jelly or jello, and they get fucking pissed off because they know exactly what you're talking about. And the best one to send out is green jello or green jelly, like mint jelly. It will fucking make somebody ballistic. Okay, so jelly is just another way of saying jealous. Now here's the one that blew me away, because I absolutely had no idea what the fuck it meant. So I want to thank my younger crew. Yes, my younger crew, for hipping a sister up. 143 means I love you. How the fuck do you get I love you out of 143? Easy. Each number represents the letters in the word. So there's one in I, four in the word love, and three in the word you. So for someone who wants to say I love you, but they kind of don't want to spell it out, that's like, you know, Fonzie, who could never say I love you. That's for my older crew who used to watch Happy Days. We used to say, or because he couldn't get the words out. Now you can just put 143 and you don't feel too bad about typing numbers, and the person who receives it knows you're saying I love you. So those are our most current dating terms. And I had a lot of fun with this because there was a hell of a lot more out there that I just could not get into this segment. But it was really fun. And I'm going to tell you something, that 143, now I got to be worried. Because what if I mean I'm you know, going to spend $143 at the store? Is somebody going to take it the wrong way? You know, or I just hit at the casino, because y'all know I'm a slot jockey. 143, hey, 143,000. Now that's some real love right there. So real quick, remember, if you're some of the etiquette and our do's and don'ts. Your words are taken literally when you're on instant messaging, so, or texting. So please, 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 please filter yourself before you send something out. The best way to filter yourself is to ask yourself, would I have actually said this to this person that I don't know to their face? If the answer is no, then you shouldn't be sending that message or text, okay? Resist the urge to get sexual too fast. And what I've done, and I don't mean not to be flirty. Flirty is supposed to be fun. Flirty is supposed to make the other person feel desired. Flirty is supposed to be a little bit naughty. But when it starts to get sexual, when it starts to get suggestive, you're going past flirty. You're going into testing the waters to see if this is a piece of ass or a piece of dick that, you know, is looking promising, okay? When you go into those areas too quickly, or it's perceived that you're going into those areas too quickly, you may not get the response that you were hoping for, okay? So be careful of that. Remember, a flirt is a tease. Entice me first. Get my interest. Keep yourself on my mind for a while, okay? Then you can start to work in the other stuff, because by then it's a natural progression. So sorry, lovers. I know things are fast in the digital age, but there are some things worth taking your time for, okay? Not everything's microwavable. Just saying. Also, too, don't be too quick. We talked about this before. Don't be too quick to take offense, okay? Because ladies, and yes, ladies, I'm getting into your shit again. Sometimes men say things, and yes, I'm talking about my brothers. Sometimes men say things that they really do mean in a complimentary way, but they do use a little crude language to say it, okay? You know, I don't know how many times I've heard, damn, you got a nice fat ass, okay? Maybe that wasn't the nicest way to say it, but coming from the person that I've gotten to know, when I hear that comment from them, it's still not the nicest way to say it, but I know you meant it as a compliment. And that gets us back to something else we talked about, and I'm going to say it again, pump your brakes on some of this, okay? Because if I don't have a chance to know your heart, to know your mind, your intellect, your personality, your quirks, your tendencies, if I don't get a chance to know the person you are, then what you text to me, I can only take as literal. Even if you didn't mean it a certain way, I don't have an opportunity to know that you possibly didn't mean it that way. So I'm going to have to go with what I see. I'm going to have to go with what a pattern is showing me. So kind of be careful with that, especially if it's anything of a sexual nature. There's a difference between being flirty, which is a little naughty, and being sexual or suggestive. Flirty is when there's some ambiguity. Flirty is when you can say something like, you know, I saw your picture and it was hard for me to sleep last night. Now, it might have been because you were so butt ugly you gave me a headache. It might have been that, hey, you kept something a little too moist and I just couldn't get the bitch to calm down, so I go to sleep. Had to grab mama's little helper. Okay, buzz, buzz, for a few minutes and get it done with. But the point of being flirty is that it could be taken in a lot of ways. I want you to take it a certain way, but I got plausible deniability in case you don't. If, on the other hand, you tell me that I'm the reason you stayed hard all day and you had to go take care of it, that's not being flirty. That's being suggestive. That's being sexual. You are describing to me an act that you had to take care of or a condition you had to take care of. Now, for some women, that might be flirty. And I'll be honest with you, to me, that's a winner if we already know each other. And like we talked about with sexting, we've already been taking care of some business. The idea that I got you needing to take care of some stuff until you can get to me, that's a compliment. The idea that you're telling me that shit and I've only known you for 2 seconds, that's a showstopper right there. We don't go past go. So you're going to have to be a little more discerning. Again, if you wouldn't say it to my face and you've only met me for 2 seconds, you shouldn't be sending me that shit. Real quick to whack up. Remember that what you post is also a record, a trail on you. Okay? Understand that. And the reason I say that is divorce lawyers fucking love Twitter. Fucking love Facebook. Fucking love Google. Why? You think you done deleted some shit. No, you didn't. All they have to do is get the IP address under subpoena and every motherfucking thing that you put in there, yes, lawyers will tell you, they can get a record of it. And now they have all these texts and tweets that you thought you even fucking got rid of, where you're propositioning this woman, where you're paying some other man's car note, while your husband or your partner or your wife is at home busting their ass to help you out, thinking that they're ride or die because you're ride or die, meaning that you're only there for each other through thick and thin. You already got their replacement and taking care of stuff. So remember, not just because of that, but also employers. Wally and I talked about this not too long ago. Employers also have the right to check. If you put it out there on social media, it's public. Unless it's a private room, it is public. And here's a newsflash. If it's a private room and you got 101 people in there, it ain't private. It stopped being private when you invited more than one person into that room, because the second you let me in, I can right click on whatever the fuck you got, copy it, paste it, save it, and you don't know what the fuck I'm going to do with it. Okay? So again, you're going to have to be careful about that. And last but not least, again, and I can't say this enough times, if you would not say it to someone's face, please, 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 let that be your filter. Don't send it as a text. Don't send it as a pic. Don't even send it in Skype or Snapchat or any other video media. Because here's the thing. Where you're seeing me now and you can get a sense of my body language, you can get a sense of my sincerity or my passion for certain things, without being able to see me, I'm just words on a screen, and you have no idea how to take those words except literally, and maybe literally is not what the fuck I meant, okay? Well, lovers, that's going to do it for this episode of the Nice and Naughty Hour. For those of you who've asked, yes, 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 I know I'm behind in updating my YouTube channel, but I promise you by the end of this week, it will be done, meaning Saturday. So don't hold me to nothing before that. But by Saturday midnight, all those episodes, including this one, will be up. And don't forget, you can still go to WLSV Radio on YouTube and catch a download of whatever you've missed, okay? So until next week, lovers, remember, life's nicer when it's naughty. Good night.